Christianity too, by the way. Proverbs chapter 14, look in verse 12. The Bible said, there is a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Even in laughter the heart is sorrowful, and the end of that mirth is heaviness. The backslider in heart shall be filled with his own ways, and a good man shall be satisfied from himself. Heavenly Father, we come to you now, certainly need your help, and we just pray that you'll touch us and anoint us afresh tonight. Help the one that might be lost. I pray that they'd come to know you as their personal Savior. Help the one that might be backslid tonight, the one that might be cold and indifferent on you. And Lord, we just pray some folk might find some help tonight from the Word of God. And the greatest place that we can ever go to find our help is in this book. And Lord, we thank you for it tonight, that you left it with us so we might know about you, your love, and your mercy, by how that we can live and please you tonight. And Lord, if somebody here just has a need tonight, I pray you'd meet needs. Again, we thank you for dying for us so that we truly, truly might be saved tonight and taking our place yonder at Calvary. Do save that sinner's nearest tail for these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Be seated tonight. I want to preach primarily in that out of verse 14 tonight. The Bible says that the backslider in heart shall be filled with his own ways. And I want to deal tonight with the thought on the being backslidden in heart. Now, we use that word and that a little loosely sometimes. The word backslide actually means to fall off or to apostatize. You know what to apostatize means? It means to turn and that from the faith. Now, there's a lot of people that's got sin in their life, and a lot of times we apply that to them being backslidden. No, they really just got sin in their life and need to get right with God. Sometimes we get cold on God, and I'll be honest with you, I truly believe that if you come to church and hear good Bible preaching and hear good Bible teaching, it's hard to get backslid. I'll just be honest about that. Now, we might grow cold and we might let some sin come in and we might get a little dirty from the world. But tonight, I believe that when somebody in that literally backslides and that on the Lord, now it ain't that they lose their salvation. Ain't you glad of that tonight? That once you're saved, you're always saved. But I'll be honest with you, I can put it in a simple fact that when somebody truly in that backslides on the Lord, that it's awful hard to tell them apart from the world tonight. And there's some Christians gets like that. Amen. But they ain't going to stay like that too long if they've truly been saved. Now, we apply a lot of times that term backsliding to people that are lost. Listen, if somebody tells me that they've been in a backslidden condition for 20 years, 25 years, and God didn't come by and deal with them and chasten them, there's something wrong with my Bible tonight. Hebrews chapter 12 says that there will be the chastening hand of God. I believe I'll tell this on Marcus that works for Nick. And you correct me if I'm wrong on my time. I believe that when after he got divorced and got to mess around in drugs, was it about 3 months? I tell you, 3 months he was standing in front of a judge being sentenced to 3 years in that in federal penitentiary. Hey, I'm telling you, God don't wait around on his people to get right. He begins to deal with them and expects them to get right. You're saying, was he saved and headed to prison? I'm determined there's a lot of folk in prison that was saved when they went in, and that was the hand of God that brought those things about, because they got in a backslidden condition. It's dangerous to get in a backslidden condition. It's dangerous and that to let sin creep into our life. It's dangerous and that to grow cold on God. And that's why you need to stay as close to God as you can tonight. I want to look at this tonight. Now, let me say that real quick by way of introduction, that if you're not saved tonight, then you can't be backsliding. You got to be saved, first of all, to backslide. Like I say, what a lot of folk needs is just a good dose in that of salvation. Bible said in verse 12, as we read it, that there is a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Does not matter what you think about what it takes to get to heaven. It matters what the Bible says about what it takes to get to heaven tonight. Does not matter how good you are, that is not going to save you. You must put your faith and trust in the blessed Lord Jesus tonight, and that gets saved. Amen. Don't come and rededicate your life. There's nothing there to rededicate. You need to come and dedicate yourself and that to God, and give Him your soul and your spirit, and say, Lord, I need to be saved. Would you save me, a sinner? And I'm glad tonight, on the promise and the authority of God's word, He'll do just that. Amen. I'm glad He saved sinners tonight. Thank God for that. Well, let me say that it's possible tonight, quickly, for any of us to backslide, no matter how spiritual we are right now. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, the Bible said, now all these things happen unto them for examples. Now, He's talking about the children of Israel. Everything that they done, if you go over and read 1 Corinthians 10, Paul lays out everything that they had done. How that they had been caught up in idolatry. How that they had disobeyed God. And I mean just one right after another. What God had done to them. When they sinned, there was punishment. When they sinned, there was punishment. When they sinned, there was punishment. Listen tonight, if you can sin and something don't bother you, then you're not saved tonight. Amen. Hey, when I do, before I do wrong, the Holy Spirit now screams out in my life and says, don't do it. And then when I do that, it says, you shouldn't have done that, and you need to stop and get right with God. But He said right here that these things, boy, I'm glad to be saved tonight. Ain't you? I'm glad. You know, why do you say that right there, preacher? Because I know I'm saved because the Holy Spirit is the one that resides in me and hollers out and tells, hey, you don't need to be doing this stuff. I'm glad that it's there tonight. He said, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Then the Bible says in the very next verse, wherefore let him thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. See, we think that we're not capable of backsliding, no matter how spiritual we are right now. But friend, we are all, every one of us, as I looked at this morning in Scripture, we're all capable of rebellion, and we're all capable of backsliding. So we go to the next verse. It said, there is no temptation taking you. So now we're talking about temptation taking you, but such is common to man. But God is faithful. Boy, ain't that good. He will not suffer you to be tempted above that you're able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it. I'm glad that we are able to bear through temptation. The Bible did not say He would take the temptation away. He said that He would just help us make it through the temptation. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 1, I believe, said, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual. You catch that? Ye which are spiritual, restore such one in a spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. We're always ready to judge people, but we ought to be quick to restore people and quick to forgive people, because we're capable of doing the exact same thing that they did. And as I said, all of us are capable of backsliding. If you look over and over and over again in the book of Jeremiah and in the book of Hosea, you'll find out that the Lord tells the nation of Israel that they were nothing but backsliders. Bible, I believe it was, and I'm not sure if it's in the book of Deuteronomy, that He told them in due time their foot would slide. And listen, just as sure enough, friend, if you're gonna sin, then you're headed down the wrong road. And you're going to end up in a backslidden condition before it's over with. Number one tonight, in the backslider in heart, because that's what He said, the backslider in heart shall be filled with his own ways. Now you remember why I'm preaching tonight, that a backslidden condition is a prideful condition. It always has to deal with pride. Always has to deal with you from this morning. If you was here this morning, I preached on rebellion. It always has to do with what you want to do, what I want to do. And that's going to lead into a backslidden condition. Now, I'll try not to be near as mean tonight as I was this morning. Sister Jerry's back there doing this right here. Amen. I'd say some of you would like that. Amen. I would too. I don't like being mean that much. Amen. But listen, number one, what produces a backslidden condition? What produces that tonight? Now we find that, first of all, that when the backslider is always going to go his own way, according to verse 14. It's always going your way and not God's way. And I think that's known tonight. I think we understand that tonight. But I ask the question, what produces a backslidden condition? Take your Bible and go to the book of Exodus, chapter 32. I want you to look with me in the book of Exodus, chapter 32. Now, let me say that, first of all, what produces and that a backslidden condition is the absence of spiritual leadership. If you have an absence of spiritual leadership in your life, it's going to produce a backslidden condition. Look with me in Exodus chapter 32. Exodus chapter 32 and verse 1. And when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, Up, make us gods which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what is become of him. All right, Moses is gone and that to receive the law, and that upon Mount Sinai, and that from God. He has been gone for a while. I believe it was in Exodus chapter 28 that Aaron has already in that been chosen to be the priest, and they come to him in verse 1 and says, we don't know what happened to Moses, but make us some gods. Now right here was the time that Aaron could have stopped them. Right here was the time that Aaron could have said, hey, I listen, the God of heaven is the one that brought you out of the land of Egypt. The very God of heaven that showed us all those plagues, killed the firstborn of the land of Egypt, that parted the Red Sea and brought us through on mighty eagle's wings and drowned the Egyptian army. It was the God of heaven that brought us out. But look what happened in verse 2. And Aaron said unto them, break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, of your sons, and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. And all the people break off the golden earrings which were in the ears, and brought them unto Aaron, and he received them at their hand, and fashioned it with a graven tool, after he had made it a molten calf. And they said, these be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. It's a wonder God didn't strike them dead right there, ain't it? I'm being honest tonight. It is a wonder that God didn't strike them down. Verse 5. And when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made proclamation and said, tomorrow is the feast of the Lord. Now I've showed you this before in verse 5. They have now in that mingled idol worship and that with heavenly worship. Because he said, tomorrow is a feast to the Lord. He's made a golden calf, and now he's going to apply and that what God had said to do unto that golden idol. Verse 6. And they rose up early on the morrow and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat and to drink and rose up to play. And the Lord said unto Moses, now looky here, go get thee down for thy people. That's what I was trying to tell you this morning. For thy people which thou brought us out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. Notice what he told Moses. He said, thy people which thou brought us out of the land of Egypt. God wasn't going to claim them. Did you catch that? God didn't say the people that I brought up out of the land of Egypt. He said, thy people, Moses, which you brought out of the land of Egypt, they've corrupted themselves. As soon as they done it, before they done it, God already knew. But what brought all this on? Moses was gone. When there's a lack of spiritual leadership in your life, listen at me now, the backsliding condition is easy to get into. That's why it's important for you to come to church. That's why it's important for you to hear preaching. That's why it's important to come to Sunday school and that to read the Word of God. That's why the Scripture is important to your life, to read it at home. That's why it is important and that to search out the Lord by prayer and by reading. It's important. You've got to have spiritual leadership. Because here's the thing. You're going to have some kind of leadership in your life. Whether it's going to be God as a spiritual leader in your life or whether it's going to be the devil as a spiritual leader in your life, somebody's going to lead your life. And you need to understand that. What did he say in the book of Proverbs? The backslider in heart shall be filled with his own ways. And so the children of Israel, they lacked and that spiritual leadership. Hey, a time when Aaron and that should have stood up and said something, he didn't. You know, I find that in some churches today where men don't pray. Hey, I'm going to be honest with you tonight. I hope that I feed you all when I preach. I'll be honest with you, I do. I hope I feed. Not only with milk, and you need milk, but you'll starve to death on milk. Do you know that? Babies will do good on milk. But you know, after you grow a little bit, you need some meat, don't you? And I mean, I'm hoping tonight that that there's been enough spiritual leadership here at this church to keep you from backsliding on the Lord. You know, there's some churches and that where all that they ever get, and I'm not picking, I guess I am tonight, all they ever get is milk. You can't survive on milk. You'll spiritually starve to death, and if you ain't careful, you'll backslide on the Lord. But if you honestly want to live for God, you can. You know, he said in the book of Jeremiah chapter 12, many pastors have destroyed my vineyard. They have trodden my portion underfoot. They have made my pleasant portion a desolate wilderness. As I told you this morning, in Jeremiah, when you stand to preach, it's very important. It's an important job. When you teach, it's a very important job tonight to hand out the Word of God. If all I fed you with was milk and all that was ever taught was milk, you'd starve to death. What produces a backsliding condition? An absence of spiritual leadership. You quit church and see how long it takes. See how long it takes before you get headed in the wrong direction. We'll look at that here in just a minute. Not only is it the absence of spiritual leadership, but then it's also the wrong association. In 1 Kings chapter 11, I'll read it. The Bible said, "For it came to pass when Solomon was old, that his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as was the heart of David his father." Now, the problem was, is Solomon began to marry wives that was not of the God of heaven, or for the God of heaven. He began to marry different wives, and he began to have different associations that the Bible said that when he got old, that his wives turned him away from God. Now, there's been a lot of wives turn their husbands from God, a lot of husbands turn their wives from God over the years. And you need to be careful tonight. Whether you're young or old, but primarily I'm going to preach to young people right now who you run with. It does matter tonight. Amen. I think as older folk, we understand that. I'm not saying that we've got it all figured out. And again, I'm going to say I used to hate when the preacher used to say, I do have some experience. Hey, listen, I'm 41 years old. I ain't that old, but I ain't that young anymore. I'm stuck in the middle, but I have learned a few things along the way. And who you run with and who you associate with does matter tonight. It's going to lead you down a path and that of backsliding. What produces a backsliding condition is who you run with. Mom and dads, you need to know who your children are running with tonight. You need to know that. You need to understand that. I pray for you youngins, and I pray for you every day. I want you to understand. I want you to know that your preacher prays for you every day. Every day, somewhere in the day, I'm on my knees praying for you. For you to do good, for you to live for God. You say, are you bragging? No, I'm not bragging, but I want you to know that your preacher loves you enough and cares enough about you to pray for you tonight. I want you to understand that. He can pray for you too, Hunter. Amen. All right. Listen, it is important. That's why the Bible said in the book of Ephesians chapter 5, see then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. What's that word circumspectly mean? That means cautiously. Now, I understand that he's talking to everybody in the book of Ephesians chapter 5 to tell us to be careful how we walk. We need to be careful how we walk. I mean, we need to be careful how we walk because of our testimony. I mean, listen, if we tell folk that we're saved, we ought to walk saved tonight. Amen. But not only should we walk saved, but we should make sure that we don't do anything to hinder that walk tonight. The Bible said in the book of Proverbs chapter 4, let thine eye, hey, you know Proverbs 4, he's telling us over there to get wisdom. Buy it, sell it not. Put it up, you know. Get it. Get all that we can. But he said, let thine eyes look right on, and thine eyelids look straight before thee. Ponder the path of thy feet, and let all thy ways be established. Turn not to the right hand, nor to the left. Remove thy foot from evil. you need to be careful who you're running with. It's going to get you into trouble if you're not careful. The absence of spiritual leadership, most of you teenagers understand that. You know, hey, you older folk know this to be true. Folk get away from God. They quit church. You know what happens? They end up in a backslidden condition most of the time. What brought them to that condition to quit church and get out of church, a lot of times it was who they were running with that got them into trouble, wasn't it? That got them in the wrong path and got them headed around the wrong direction. What else causes a backslidden condition? You know that worldly lust and worldly success can cause it. Now I understand that worldly success does not always cause an added backslidden condition. Some people know how to deal with it. Now right now I'm talking about what produces a backslidden condition. Worldly success can, but love for the world will. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 15, that's why it tells us to love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. He told us not to love the world. He said in the book of Colossians to set your affection on things above, not on things below. Luke chapter 8, he put it like this. He's talking about the sower that went forth to sow. And he said, and that which fell among the thorns are they, which when they had heard, go forth, and are choked with cares and riches and pleasures of this life, and bring no fruit to perfection. Now, if you fall in love with this world, if you fall in love with it, you're going to end up in a backslidden condition. If you fall in love with money, you're certainly going to be in a backslidden condition. 1 Timothy chapter 6, but they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare and into many foolish and hurtful lusts which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. That's what he said about money. Preacher, we've got to have money. I ain't talking about having it or the lack of it. I'm talking about loving it. I'm talking about loving money tonight. There's a difference in needing money to make the world go around. There's a difference in needing money to pay your light bill and to make your house payment than falling in love with money where you can't have enough. I'll tell you right now and show you people that they've got all kinds of money. Some of them's probably got more money than all of us put together in here tonight. And they lay away. I know this to be the truth. Or I was told this to be the truth. Let's put it like that. I taught online this past Thursday. I guess what did I tell you? If I'm going to lie, if I was lied to, I'm going to lie to y'all too. But they lay awake at night worrying about their money. Glenn ain't got that problem. I ain't got that problem. I ain't got that problem lying awake night worrying about my money. God's going to take care of me. Amen. I'll never forget. We was coming up on Y2K. How many of y'all remember that? Huh? Some of y'all wasn't even born and don't know what I'm talking about. Huh? Some of you was just little. Huh? Y2K. World was coming to an end. Our computer couldn't count from 0 to 1. You know, that's what was about to happen. You remember that? Oh man, I remember hearing message after message how the world was coming to an end. We'd go to preacher's fellowships and boy, I'm telling you, Jesus was soon to come. And He is soon to come, amen. But I mean, the world was coming to an end. But I'll never forget Buster Seaton come to our home church. He stood up and he preached and he made a statement and I ain't never forgot. He said, if God wants to take care of me, He can rain $10 bills down out of heaven and He'll take care of me. Yes! Ain't that true tonight, amen. God will take care of us no matter what. Hey, David said, I've been young and now I'm old. Yeah, I've not seen the righteous forsaken, nor a seed of begging bread. Brother Jeff looked at it in Sunday school this morning. What did we look at? That he said that he had promised us that he'd never leave us nor forsake us. I don't know how we got there, but ain't it good tonight? Let me tell you tonight that if you have success in this world, you be careful with it tonight. You be careful with your money. Listen, he told Timothy over there in the very next verse after he talked about the love of money, but thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. That's what you ought to be doing tonight. Don't be chasing money tonight. Don't be chasing worldly things. You're going to end up in a backslidden condition. Number two, tonight, I want you to look at the path of backsliding. Take your Bible and go to the book of Luke chapter 15 tonight. The backslider will be filled with his own ways in his heart. Now listen to me now. Luke chapter 15. We find a very, very familiar scripture here talking about the prodigal son right here. Now the word prodigal does not mean one that had went away or one that had wandered away. The word prodigal actually means wasteful. And that's what the prodigal son does. He wasted what his daddy gave him. And I'm going to be honest with you tonight. If you're backslid on God, you're a prodigal son. You're wasting what fathers give you tonight. Now look with me in Luke chapter 15. I'll read this and then we'll hurry tonight, okay? He said a certain man, verse 11, and he said a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that fall to me. And he divided unto them. Remember that. He divided unto them. Both boys got what was coming to them. Divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. He went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat. No man gave unto him. Now, we read that story very fast tonight, and that for time's sake, but it took a while and that to get out of this situation. And when I say a while, I'm sure it took 2 or 3, 4 weeks. It may have took a couple of months and that to get here. But I want you to look. Now, always remember what I said. A backslider in heart is filled with his own ways. You remember that? Remember what the text scripture said? Backslider in heart is filled with his own ways. What's happened right here? Younger son said what? Father, give me the portions of good that falleth to me. He wanted his inheritance because that's the only way that he could get away. It wasn't no accident that short not many days after in verse 13 that the son gathered all together, and the Bible said that he took his journey into a far country. Man, he hopped on the first locomotive that was blowing smoke, and he was getting out of town. I mean, he was leaving the father. He was leaving the family. He was leaving the faith. He was leaving everything behind looking for a good time. And I'm talking about the path that leads to being backslid. You remember the very first thing that I told you that causes it, what produces it? There's no spiritual leadership in his life. He's got away from his daddy. He's got away from the preacher. He's got away from his mama that loves him. Man, he's got away from everybody that cared for him, that cared for his soul, that taught him in Sunday school, that done everything to get him in line with God so that he could serve God. And he leaves and goes to a far country. Let me park right here and say this for just a second. When he got into the far country, the father did not follow him. And the father did not finance him when he got down in the far country. Too many parents keep on enabling their children when their backs are on God. I understand, give them a meal, give them a place to live. If they're going to have to live in the street, they are your children. I understand you thinking there. I'm not going to argue with you. Hey, but friend, I'm telling you, sometimes God gets folk in a position where he can deal with them and they'll get right. You notice the father didn't go down here and bail him out. Sometimes the best thing to do, just let a set of handcuffs be put on them. Ain't that right? That's right. Amen. You say, you're awful mean about that. No, I'm trying to keep you out of trouble tonight. Young people, I'm really trying to keep you out of trouble. I mean, you're facing more than I ever thought about facing when I was your age. And I still think I'm young. I don't think I got old yet. Talking about being old baldy this morning. I thought I was going to get there the other day. He's left everything that he knows. Why didn't he just go into the next city? Why didn't he just go down to his aunt and uncle's house? Why didn't he just go 2 or 3 cities far away? But the Bible makes a point in that to tell us that he went into the far country. He wanted to get as far away as he possibly could. He could not live like he wanted to live anywhere close to home. They knew him. They knew him. But I tell you, you can't get away from people. Do you know that? Me and my wife went up the other day. Well, yesterday, as a matter of fact, was up in a little place called Midtown. If y'all know where Midtown is, that falls between Kingston and Rockwood, Kingston and Herman, falls all in between that. And we were sitting there eating at a restaurant, and lo and behold, I'm 30, 35 minutes from the house, don't know anybody there. Lo and behold, here comes a deacon and a wife from a sister church that I know. I said, what y'all doing up here? Oh, we just live about 12 miles from here. Oh. You never know, do you? See, that's why he went down into the far country. But he didn't go one state away. He went through four states away. He's getting away from everybody. I'm telling you right now, if you got that in your mind, you hang on and listen to the rest of the story. I can't wait to get away from home, preacher. I can't wait to do it. All right, just hold on. If that's your agenda tonight, your heart's already not right with God. And you need to deal with it. So the Bible said right here that he spent all that he had. He wasted his substance with riotous living. And he has spent all that he had. And then the Bible makes a point to tell us that when he had spent all, in verse 14, that there arose a mighty famine in that land. And he began to be in want. Did you know that the good times always run out? Listen to me now. Always. Always. He spent all. Listen, his father gave him his inheritance. He's got a suitcase full of money when he left home. He's got his ring of sonship. He's got his floorsome shoes on leaving the house. He's got his robe on. He looks good. Everything's going well for him. He leaves home, gets in the far country, spends all that he had, has to pawn his ring, has to pawn his shoes, has to pawn his coat. It's all gone. And then not only on top of that, then the Bible said in verse 14 that there arose a mighty famine in that land. Ain't even hardly no work to be had. Ain't no farming to be done. Face of famine, ain't no farming to be done, and there ain't no food to be had. Think about that. There's a famine. And then the Bible said he began to be in want. What's happened to the young man that has left home? What's happened to the young man that has left home with wild eyes and wild ideas and a heart full of himself, suitcase full of money, ready to go? What's happened to him now? Now I'm talking about the path that brings you into a backslidden condition. When this boy left home, he never intended to be in this condition. I'm determined some folk, when they quit church or they're just going to miss a few times of church, I'm going to lay in bed this morning. We're going to go here tonight and do that. Hey, there's nothing really any more important than being in church tonight. I understand sickness. I understand all those things. God understands those things. I understand we get hindered from time to time. But when we place things in front of it, hey, you're headed down the wrong path. I'd rather be in church, be anywhere. There's times I just like to come in here and sit down on the front pew and just sit here. I come and pray and I sit down. I like to be in the church house. You say, you're strange, preacher. Maybe I am, but I like to be in church. God's met with me a couple of times in church. How about you tonight? All right, the path. How am I doing tonight? Am I all right? I hope so. I want you to look what happened to him. I'm hurrying. I'm paying attention what time it is. Now he's lost everything and he's in want. And the Bible said that he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. And he sent him to his fields to feed swine. Boy, here I believe you've got a little Jewish boy right here, young man. One of the worst things that he could do is feed with them hogs over there. Boy, just horrible. Horrible thing to do. Fool with them hogs. Hey, listen, he's had to go find somebody that of that country where he's at and he sent him down there and that to feed the hogs. And not only has he sent him down there to feed the hogs, the Bible said in verse 16 that he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave. And hey, listen, he would have ate the same slop that the hogs was eating. Boy, you get in a backslidden condition, and there ain't no telling what you'll be eating before it's over with. Are you hearing me now? I'm trying to keep you from getting there. Oh, preacher, it'll never get there. Okay. Okay. You go ahead and believe that. And let's see who's right at the end of it all. Let's see if I'm right or you're right. Because you know who I know is going to be right? This book. This book's going to be right. Scares me to death, even think about it. Here he is, he's going to feed swine. He is as low can get. I believe that path took him further than he wanted to go. He didn't know what to do. Now, listen. If you're truly saved and in a backslidden condition, it ain't going to go good. How do you know, preacher? Proverbs 13 and 15, the latter part of that verse, or the whole verse said, good understanding giveth favor, but the way of transgressors is hard. Hard. Ways of transgressors is hard. You know, Galatians 6 and 7, be not deceived, God is not mocked, whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. Amen. It's going to come to pass. You may not think so. You may not think his preacher knows what he's talking about, or that you're getting away. You ain't getting away with nothing. There's God in heaven watching every bit of it. You ain't getting away with nothing. I ain't getting away with nothing. Number three. Last of all. Boy, ain't you glad. Listen. What produces in that backslidden condition? Lack of spiritual leadership. Who you're running with. Worldly lust and worldly success can lead to that. But we find in Luke chapter 15 the path and that of a backslidden condition. There comes a time when you forsake God that you're going to end up in that position. But number three, the passageway back to the Lord. Now listen. I don't know what road he took down there. I don't know what road he took down there to the far country. But I do know this, that the Bible goes on to tell us right here, and when he came to himself, there in verse 17, when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say in him, Father, I have sinned against heaven. Well, looky there. Well, see who he brought up first. Brought up the God of heaven there, didn't he? I've sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. Now let me say this, that he got right down in the hog pen. As right as he could get. Why do you say that? You'll see here in a minute. He got as right as he could in the hog pen. He didn't go back home to get right. He got right where he was. Well, now watch this. And he arose and came to his father. Now, he has journeyed down to the far country. Y'all know where I'm headed with this. He still had to make that same journey from the far country back to the house. Except this time, he has to do it without a suitcase full of money. He has to do it without shoes on his feet, a ring on his hand, and a coat on his back. You say, well, preacher, he got right in the hog pen. He did. But he's now got to come home and make some things right at home. You understand what I'm saying? You understand what I'm saying tonight? Listen, he had a long journey coming back home. And he understood that when he was headed back home, that he's got to make things right. Hey, listen, for you to get right, to honestly get right and get out of the backslidden condition, you may have to make some things right with some people. You may have burnt down and blowed up some bridges on the way out of town. Now you think about that for just a second. I'm going to do what I want to do. Don't you bother me and leave me alone. Okay. Might as well. Took a match, throwed it to the TNT and blowed the bridge up. I don't think you could talk this boy out of doing what he wanted to do to save his life. But the Bible said that he arose, came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him. I believe he was looking for him. I honestly believe that with all my heart. I believe that man went out every day and looked out that road. You can't convince me otherwise, because the Bible said right here, and when he was yet a great way off, he seen him coming. His father saw him and had compassion. Boy, ain't that good. Had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. That tells me that boy was already on the ground by the time his daddy got there. That boy probably seen his daddy coming, running out there to meet him. And that boy down on his knees, he was already in that, ready, willing to be a servant unto his father. And the son said unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight. No more word be called thy son. Now you remember what the rest, of his story was over here? He said, no more word be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. But the Bible said, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight. No more word be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, shoes on his feet, and bring here the fatted calf and kill it, and let's eat and be merry. He said, for this my son was dead and alive. He again was lost and was found, and they began to be merry. Boy, his father wouldn't even let him finish what he wanted to say about being servant. He was tickled to death to have him back home. You can get right. You can get right with God, and you can get right with your fellow man. 1 John chapter 1 said, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Proverbs chapter 28, he that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. You just got to come and get right. That's what it takes. Now I hope you're right tonight and not in a backslidden condition. Because you're miserable if you're in a backslidden condition. Miserable. This old boy, listen. This old preacher, I'm doing what I want to, and I ain't in backslidden. I'm doing all right. Well, either you're lying or you ain't saved. One of the other. Because I'll just tell you now, you can't do wrong, get by if you're saved tonight. It's too much in this scripture. Way too much in this scripture tonight. And as I've said before, God don't wait 15 and 20 and 30 years to show up. You don't wait for a long time to correct your children, do you? Well, God ain't going to neither. Let's bow our heads tonight. Cross hands. Let's get this verse of invitation tonight. Listen, if you're living for the Lord, you continue to live for God. And be careful not to backslide. Be careful tonight. But maybe you're headed that way. The Bible said in the book of Luke chapter 9, I believe it was verse 62, he said, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Is that you tonight? Are you looking that way? Are you looking toward that far country? Are you doing all that you can to get away from preaching, get away from church, get away from home? Just get away, get away, get away. Where I can do what I want to do. You do what you want to do, the backslider in heart is filled with his own ways. Going to get you in trouble. Going to get you in trouble tonight. If you backslid, if there's some sin in there, if you've grown cold, you can come get right, get refreshed, get right with God, get right with your fellow man, get right with your brother tonight and your sister in Christ. But if you're unsaved tonight, why don't you come and get saved? Why don't you come? Heavenly Father, I pray that you'll move during this invitation. And thank you for helping us tonight, giving us clarity of mind and of heart tonight. and clarity of speech. What such a warning that you've given us tonight, and that of a backsliding condition, that it is possible, and that for Christians to backslide. It is possible for us to do wrong and get away from you. But Lord, you're not going to wait too long to begin to get our attention. Lord, I pray tonight you may be trying to get somebody's attention right now before they get headed down the wrong path. And I pray that you'll speak to their heart tonight. Lord, if there's somebody here that's lost, save them. And Lord, I pray you'll help during this invitation for these things. In Jesus' name, amen.